In the span of a single lifetime, a momentous transformation in human consciousness has quietly taken hold. We are beginning to think of our home not as the Earth, but as the solar system. Thanks to the photographic output of a small squadron of interplanetary spacecraft, a picture of the visual splendor and variety of the solar system is emerging. Since then, probes built with more powerful cameras and greater maneuverability have looked deeper into the turbulent clouds and wheeling satellites of Jupiter, roamed the boulder-strewn red deserts of Mars, studied Saturn's immaculate rings, and chronicled vast upheavals erupting from the Sun itself. Before modern telescopes, humans could only imagine what the surface of the Sun and the planets looked like. Now advanced technology has made it possible to get in close and take images of the Sun and the planets deep in our solar system. If you guys have the patience to follow us for about 10 minutes, we'll show you the profound difference between the planetary images of a few years ago, definitely ugly, and those that delight our eyes today. Solar system. How real images of planets changed before and after the digital revolution. Episode 1. From the Sun to Mars. Okay guys, I admit it. By now I have reached an age that allows me to compare, for having personally lived it, the pre-Apollo and pre-digital era with the one we are living in this moment in the field of space exploration and scientific imaging. This means that I was a kid when in school books, photos of planets were just fuzzy black and white blobs. But one can go back even further. There was indeed a time when planets, apart from the Sun and Moon, could only be perceived by us Earthlings as more or less bright points of light. This period lasted from when the first representative of our species raised his eyes to the sky, wondering for the first time what were all those lights that lit up after the sunset, until the invention of the telescope in 1609. The next period is from the invention of the telescope until the early 60s of the last century, approximately 3.5 centuries, during which astronomers have first tried to draw the scarce and often illusory details that could discern on planetary disks devastated by atmospheric turbulence, and then pass, at the beginning of the 20th century, to the first timid attempts of photographic shooting. With mostly disappointing results, always due to turbulence, even more exacerbated by the fact that the poor sensitivity of the films of the time forced astronomers to very long poses, even with bright subjects such as planets. And the longer a pose is, the more turbulence cancels, contrasts, and erases details. In short, we can certainly say that until the 60s, the planetary photos taken from Earth, even those of the great observatories like Palomar and Mount Wilson, judged with the eyes of the present, could be defined as very disappointing. This state of affairs lasted until the first interplanetary probes, equipped not with film, but with cathode ray tubes, entered the field. The Mariner 4, for example, in 1965, sent home the first close-up photos of the Martian surface, in black and white and with a resolution, today ridiculous, of 210 lines by 210 columns. Sufficient, however, to destroy forever the theory of channels and to show us a world very different from what we had imagined. Mars appeared, in fact, studded with craters, almost like the Moon. It did not have a magnetic field worthy of note, and therefore was exposed from solar radiation, and the atmosphere was cold and thin. No evidence of alien civilizations, of course, nor any hope of easy exploration. But the image we had of the solar system began to change totally only in 1976 with the Viking probes that landed on Mars, and then with the Pioneer and Voyager in the 80s. It was then, in fact, that the old dimensionless points of light and the ugly blurry photographs of the turn of the century suddenly became shapes, colors, and phenomena in flux. No longer faded postcards, but worlds and moons with mountains, volcanoes, and ice. In the years that followed, all the planets of the solar system were visited and photographed by automatic probes, but also the imaging from the ground, assisted by CCD sensors, increasingly large and sensitive, made giant processes, giving us enhancing views of the planets closer and more telegenic. And not only by professional astronomers in large observatories, but also by astrophotographers equipped with absolutely amateur instruments. This was the real great revolution. Digital sensors within everyone's reach. not only, but the general increase in image quality also depended on another factor. In the past, images of the solar system were acquired by capturing a single image through a simple eyepiece projection adapter, an accessory that allowed a medium to high power eyepiece to be placed between the telescope and camera body, attached to the focuser of a telescope. It has largely been replaced by a process that is known as lucky imaging. This method allows for the capture of hundreds to thousands of individual frames taken with a high-speed video camera in a very short amount of time, and then stacking the best of those frames to form a final image that can be further enhanced with sharpening techniques. But it is time to bring some evidence for what we are saying. For example, look at these photographs of the sun taken by the Mount Wilson Observatory in 1946 and the National Astronomical Observatory of Japan in 1984. At the time, they were as good as it gets, and then compare them with the extraordinary color images below. Amazing the difference, isn't it? All thanks to telescopes designed for the specific observation of the sun, such as the Gregor telescope of the Canary Islands, to which we owe the beautiful animation that shows the evolution in 20 minutes of a sunspot of 20,000 kilometers in diameter. And above all, thanks to the very high-resolution digital sensors and the latest generation of adaptive optics systems. And what about the photographic shots of the amateur astronomer Alan Friedman, who in recent years has literally changed the standard of solar imaging with its special processing? Color, light, here the astronomical object is shown as a work of art exhibited in the case of a museum. Let's not talk about probes such as the Solar Dynamics Observatory, which for many years now, minute by minute, has been monitoring the sun in all its aspects and at all wavelengths, giving us incredible views of what in its movies appears for what it is, a real atomic furnace. Frightening images. Hey guys, hold on a second before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality. Let's continue in order. From the brightest and most obvious object of the solar system, we pass to one of the most hidden, so much so that even Copernicus admitted he had never been able to see it. Mercury. The small planet, since it is the closest to the sun, seen from Earth, often appears in the glow of morning or evening twilight, and until the era of probes on its brilliant surface, had never been reported any detail. Even with the best telescopes and in the best photographs, all you could get was an indistinct smudge of light in the form of a sickle. With the digital era, things have improved, but only the probes from Mariner 10 in 1974 to Messenger in 2008 to 2015 were then able to reveal the appearance of its surface, which as you can see in the film made by Messenger, appears cratered like the lunar one. In the photographic realm, Venus's story is also somewhat similar to that of Mercury. Despite Venus being more convenient to observe and much larger and closer to Earth, its perennial cloud cover has always prevented us from photographing its surface, with the glorious exception of the extraordinary photos taken by the Soviet Venera series probes that landed on the planet from 1970 onwards. And in this regard, do you want to know something? It is not all true that Perseverance was the first probe to capture the wind noise on an alien planet. The first one to do so was Venera 13 itself in 1982, and you can hear it very well in the film that we propose. However, it was Magellan who put things right with the topography of Venus. In the early 90s, the NASA probe realized, in fact, the entire mapping of the Venusian surface using radar shots capable of piercing the thick layer of clouds. So much that by now we can say to have an excellent knowledge of the geological structure of this mysterious planet. And after Venus? Well, proceeding towards the outside of the solar system, it is impossible not to stop and contemplate for a moment that oasis full of life that is our planet, the pale blue dot, as Sagan defined it. And to underline, also in this case, the enormous improvement in the images, we will show you two very similar shots. The first photographic portrait of our planet taken on August 23, 1966 by Lunar Orbiter 1, and the one taken by the Apollo 8 crew only 28 months later in December of 1968. It's an incredible difference, don't you think? As well as incredible, years later will be the shots of the Earth-Moon system made by the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. And we've already arrived at Mars, the alter ego par excellence of our planet, and therefore observed, designed, and photographed by generations of astronomers. A definitely photogenic planet, at least during its maximum approaches, which are repeated every 15 to 17 years. Until the 50s, however, the photos were so confusing to make believe that it could host at least plant life. There were in fact no traces of craters, and nothing made to think it could be an arid world. All this we have already said until in 1965, Mars was not visited by the probe Mariner 4. Then the Viking in 1976 gave us the first landscapes, so similar to those of our desert regions, while the advent of digital produced images of the red planet increasingly detailed even among those taken by terrestrial telescopes. The Hubble Space Telescope has often participated in this competition of ability, with global images of Mars full of details. Nowadays, with the many probes that still turn around, we can say we know the Martian topography even greater than that of the Moon, especially thanks to the extraordinary capabilities of the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, operational since 2006. The film that we show you is worth more than 100 words. And after Mars? After Mars, the asteroids. But this will be a goal that we will reach in the next video appointment, when we will discover the best images of asteroids and comets, and then of Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto. And also for each of these objects, we will show you a before and an after, testifying the enormous progress made by astronomical imaging in recent years. See you soon.